In 1849, a French writer named Jean-Baptiste Alphonse Carr wrote, "The more things change, the more they stay the same," proving that he didn't really understand what change is, and simultaneously explaining why no one reads his work today. Real change shakes things up, and radical change means that things never return to the way they were. For example, COVID was certainly real change and almost certainly radical change, but only time will tell. In the world of bass fishing, there's been some real change over the past half century, but arguably no radical change until now. Fisheries biologists, that is, ichthyologists, have been looking through the shiny new tools in their toolbox and using things like DNA analysis to identify entirely new species of bass, or to reclassify what was formerly a subspecies, like the Florida bass, as its own species. The initial result of all this is that most of the scientific names for the Micropterus genus are now antiquated and will no longer be used by those in the know. What was Micropterus salmoides is now something else, and the Florida bass is no longer a subspecies of the largemouth. It is its own species. In addition to that, there are a bunch of new species, and more are coming. Today, there are 14 members of the Micropterus genus. That's up from 9 just a short time ago. In another few years, there's reason to believe there will be 19. Unfortunately, that doesn't mean we actually have more bass to catch, just more classifications to put them in, more characteristics to learn, more arguments with fishing friends about identification. But the plus side of all this is that more species means there'll be more spots in the record books, state, national, and even international. In fact, there's probably never been a better time to pursue a world record bass than right now. For others, an existing record endures. For some, it means there is no current world record. It's open. The slate has been wiped clean. That's what tonight's show is all about, the shakeup of bass classifications, the rewriting of state, national, and international record books, and a better understanding of how science looks at our favorite game fish. To add to the shakeup, tonight's episode is a joint venture between Bass After Dark and the Big Bass Podcast, hence the smoking jacket and the ascot for the former and the cap for the latter. I know they clash, but I'm kind of a fashion trendsetter. I think this look is eventually going to become all the rage. So stick with us. This is going to be a fascinating conversation, one that we've really been looking forward to. Welcome to Bass After Dark, and welcome to the Big Bass Podcast. I'm Ken Duke, one of the co-hosts of both those shows, and tonight we're going to bring you a topic that is right in the wheelhouse of each of them. Now let's bring out my co-host for Bass After Dark. It's the one, the only, Brian the Carpenter.
Thank you, Ken. A wonderful monologue as always. Super excited. Yes, lose the hat. Yes.
Gotta lose the hat just because it's hot.
That's the Ken Duke I know.
There you go.
There you go. Much better.
This is what we've been working on for a while, BTC. It's great that it's finally here. I almost didn't make the show. I had some sort of allergic reaction to something yesterday. I've been trying to shake that, but really thrilled to be here. We've got a great panel. And we've got another co-host on this show, too.
Yes, you put quite the scare into us all, Ken.
Not hardly.
Oh, yes. Yes, we do. And he is a returning guest. And as you spoke before, your co-host with the Big Bass Podcast, he is a doctor, I believe. He's also the son of immigrant goat farmers, Dr. Terry Battisti.
Thanks, BTC. I love you, man. Ken, it's great to be on Bass After Dark again.
That's right. Terry is this is Terry's first time as a guest co-host, but he was a guest in the very first episode of Bass After Dark. And he was a guest on an episode that I didn't do. So where BTC was the lone host. So welcome back, Doctor. We appreciate you being here with us.
And Kenny's got another podcast in the works he was telling me about yesterday.
Oh, tell us about
the Big Goat Podcast.
The Big Goat Podcast. Okay.
Yep, that's right.
Yep. Mm-hmm. BGP.
That's right.
I did not know about this, but I can't say I'm terribly surprised. But Brian, he has.
We like our goats here.
I thought I had a pretty good excuse for missing tonight's show because I'm not even sure I can make it through, but I'm hopped up on cold meds. So maybe I can get it. But Dr. Battisti, you had a mishap this morning that almost took you out of the lineup.
Yeah, I slipped on the wet grass this morning and broke an ankle. So if you hear me wince in pain or see me wince in pain, it's because I've tried to move my leg to make it more comfortable and failed.
Well, you've either caused pain in your leg or BTC has caused you pain with some of his jokes at your expense.
I just don't understand why BTC hates me.
No, I don't hate you, Terry.
We don't have time for a list like that long. Hey folks, if you're not new to Bass After Dark, we really would appreciate your liking, sharing, subscribing, commenting on the show. That helps us a lot. And if you've never seen the Big Bass Podcast, go check that out. This is a joint effort. This will be available on either channel, but check out the Big Bass Podcast. We really enjoy that. At BTC, we've got kind of a really big announcement before we get started on tonight's show proper. Couple of them.
Yes, we do. Well, first of all, we have a product giveaway tonight. This is a like and share on Facebook. So guys, if you're on Facebook, please like, comment, share the Facebook feed. If you're over here on YouTube, take a minute, jump over there, jump on your Facebook account. Giving away a really cool prize pack from Lures and Lead. The prize pack is 5 exclusive missile baits, jigs. They did a co-op deal with Greenfish Tackle. They are the Bassmaster Classic rubber skirted missile baits jigs. So we're giving away 5 of them. And Lures and Lead, it's a new venture, new site. Buddy Justin Kimmel is a part of. And a new retailer of sorts, but different, you know. He's on the inside and you know, bringing exclusive baits, you know. They have all the missile baits jigs. That's the only place you can get them, the co-op jigs with Greenfish Tackle. And what does read a certain something here, they see the things they dropped this week: the Bassmaster Classic Living Rubber missile baits jigs. They got Sakamata shads. Again, they got another load in. And the new stealth rig, that clear A rig, luresandlead.com. Guys, check them out. It's pretty cool because, like, every week they're going to be doing new releases of something exclusive that's kind of trending on tour, you know, exclusive colors, this, that, and the third.
And BTC, if I'm not mistaken, that this week's giveaway has an MSRP of something north of $100,000, I believe.
That is correct, Ken. You would be absolutely correct in that.
Big money. And can I also make an announcement about a new sponsor we have?
Please do.
The Bass Tank. You know, a lot of you have heard of the Bass Tank. Well, the Bass Tank was founded in 2018 in an effort to help anglers of all levels and interests get more out of their fishing experience. With all the tools that are available to us today, it's easy to make a product or installation mistake that can cost you thousands of dollars and even more fish. But with the help of the Bass Tank, these problems can be avoided. They have experts ready to help you make the right decisions when choosing gear and getting it set up for peak efficiency. So whether you're looking to upgrade to the latest available units or just want some basic tools for your boat, check them out at thebasstank.com.
Outstanding.
Now, of course, this banter, which, you know, who can get enough of this? But apart, we got our conversation coming up in a moment, but also we've got bad comments coming up after our main conversation here. And that's where we invite everybody joining us through YouTube to jump in the chat. Keep these things pointed at me or BTC or Terry Battisti, because by that time our guests will be thanked and off the program. So keep it to us or perhaps Jacob the intern or Nathan, you know. And we got a great top 10 tonight. We let Terry Battisti help us in the top 10. And if there are any items in the top 10 that you think are not funny, no doubt he wrote them.
Yes. Top 10 wet grass mishaps of Terry Battisti.
No,
no.
We could have done it. We would have had the time.
No, Terry made some great contributions to that. And the actual top 10 list is signs you're in a bad bass club.
Yes.
And then we close the show out with my favorite segment, perhaps, which is
yes,
Brian the Carpenter's Dark Thoughts.
Yes. And Terry is going to join me tonight. Stick around to the end and join me in Dark Thoughts. Did you know that, Terry?
I had no clue, but that doesn't surprise me.
Yes, you are.
Sometimes you just have to let the show flow over you, Terry.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
That's what I've learned.
I've got another name for that.
BTC, what is our question tonight? And let's get our guests out.
Our question tonight is a new world record upon us.
Yeah, is there a new world record bass that's coming right around the corner, and why? And BTC, can you introduce our panelists for the evening?
I can. Let me get my special decoders on. This decodes the blurriness in front of me. We have an assistant professor of biology at the University of North Georgia, earned his PhD in fisheries and aquatic ecology from Oklahoma State University, and did his undergraduate and master's studies at the University of Georgia, Dr. Andrew Taylor.
Andrew, welcome so much to the show.
Hey, thank you for having me on.
This is a thrill. It's always a thrill to talk to somebody who is hyper-educated, as I would classify anyone, from the University of Georgia. So welcome.
Thanks for having me. Go Dogs.
Go Dogs. Exactly. Exactly. Now, I know our other guests, unfortunately, were not educated at the University of Georgia, but these are also hyper-smart people and extraordinarily knowledgeable about the topic tonight. So BTC, carry on, please, sir.
Yes. We have the Angler Recognition Manager for the International Game Fish Association. That's the IGFA. He received his undergraduate degree in environmental science from Endicott College. He then received a master's degree in aquaculture from the University of Miami. We have Zack Bellapigna.
Thanks for having me. Perfect pronunciation, by the way, BTC.
Zack, I know I speak for Terry and myself when I say we envy your job to be in charge of the records and stuff like that, to have access to all those record applications that rest behind you. And I did warn you that Terry and I will be breaking in one night dressed as ninjas.
I will leave the door unlocked for you guys. I'll show you around even.
You should
I have paper envy for what all those stacks you got behind you right now.
It is boring.
Well, Zack, thank you so much. We're thrilled you're here. You see, we got one more panelist tonight, and he's going to be familiar face to those who have watched the Big Bass Podcast and who have watched Bass After Dark.
That's right. Our next, he's got a bachelor's degree in freshwater biology from Tarleton State University and a master's degree in fishery science from Texas A&M. Also the biologist for Major League Fishing, owns a private lake management company called Texas Pro Lake Management, and has personally grown largemouth bass up to 17 and a half pounds. We've got Steve.
Steven Bardin, thank you so much for joining us. You know, these other guys are hyper-educated. You went to school in Texas. I will ask them to speak slowly just to help you out.
Hey. I'm here to go ahead and take my crown as the person that's been on both of your podcasts the most times. So I'll take that right now. And I'm here to balance out with BTC because this is a totally nerdy podcast. So at least I'm here with BTC.
Yeah, that's right. And we're thrilled to have you. You're one of our favorite guys in the whole industry. We appreciate you. Terry, you have something to say to Professor Bardin here?
I do. Steve, ask them how they spell dogs, and that'll give you an idea of how bright they are, okay?
I think Andrew will back me up on this when I say that the Dogs have taken two out of the last three national championships in college football. Enough said. Ooh, and we're cheated out of it.
Before we dive into this, I just want to read a message, a comment on the message board, just to really kind of set the stage and get things going. From Anthony Geis, Ken and Terry going through all those files would be like teenagers finding an entire library of Playboys, making pages stick together.
Zack, that's pretty accurate. We'd probably scream like 12-year-old girls at a Beatles concert.
See, now I'm a little more concerned.
Yeah, well, yeah, you really should be.
You're new here. You're new here. You'll find out.
It's not good, Zach. It's not good. I'm not sure what our problem is, but I know it's hard to pronounce. That's all I can say at the moment. All right, I'm going to throw this open to the three of you guys, and y'all can fight amongst yourselves, because this is such a complicated topic, I think, for me, that I don't know exactly where to begin. But I know just a few years ago, there were 9 species of black bass, 9 members of the Micropterus genus. How many do we have now? And where have the changes taken place?
I defer to you.
Oh, Andrew, you're up.
Yeah,
can I chime in?
Yes, please. So
that's a great question, Ken. And I don't even really know that we were settled on 9. So okay. Like one of the issues that, you know, I think one of the issues we've had, like as a scientific community and communicating to the angling community, is that there were mixed messages all along the way. Like the science has been in flux for a long time, right? We've been making new discoveries, revising those discoveries. And so I think everyone was kind of getting mixed messages, but yeah, I think, you know, basically we're talking about going from about 9 to now about 14. And it's not like the change happened overnight. It's really over the last couple of decades as we've applied more genetic tools and kind of looked more broadly across the range of all these critters. We've kind of picked up on things that we might have missed before. So we do kind of have a good understanding now of what diversity is out there. We've kind of looked, there was a paper that I was a part of recently by Damon Kim, took the lead authorship on that. And he basically, you know, we as a group of co-authors said, wouldn't it be great if we took all the known species that lab, you know, this lab over here in Texas found, and this lab over here in Georgia found, and this lab over here in Oklahoma found, and kind of look at them all under the same method, under the same kind of scrutiny, level of scrutiny, and kind of figure out once and for all, like draw a line in the sand, how many species really are there, right? And so we did that. And we found that it matched up really well with what we kind of already were learning from all these individual labs all along, which is great, right? Because then you're like, oh, we can be really sure about this. And so kind of the findings of that Kim paper, Damon Kim paper, kind of led right into the American Fishery Society, which is one of like the preeminent professional societies for scientists who do fish stuff. They have a names of fishes committee that's kind of the gatekeepers of like, which species are we going to actually adopt into our vernacular of science? And they took a look at all the previous work and that Damon Kim paper and said, this is a bulk of knowledge and there's a lot of agreement here. And so they basically said, yep, we've got these 14. And that just happened earlier this year. That was as of like 2023 or end of 2023, beginning of 2024. So we feel really good about that. And I think one of the main things that I want to try to, you know, communicate to the group tonight is just how amazing all that diversity is. Like we have so many cool species of bass, and I venture to say most of us don't really know a lot about what they look like, where they live, how to catch them, all that good stuff.
This fascinates me, and I'm soaking up everything you have to say, Andrew. Let me ask what may be a weird question, but hopefully it'll make conceptual sense and help. And I know it'll help me a little bit. We talk about AFS. I'm certainly familiar with the American Fishery Society and a little bit about what it does. Because the bass is an American fish, more or less, certainly a North American, Central American fish, does AFS get any pushback from other organizations about any of these classifications and renaming, or does AFS kind of drive the bus here? And I'm throwing that question open to everybody on the panel.
So, Ken, the committee is made up of ichthyologists, wildlife biologists, and people from American Fishery Society. So it's not just one group that's determining this nomenclature that we're going to accept. So they take, like Andrew was saying, they take the papers that have been recently published. They meet, Andrew, what is it, every 12 years, something. I mean, we're only on the 8th edition of names ever. So they meet periodically, they go over the names, and then they go line by line voting on them. So it's not just Micropterus that has a lot of name changes that happened in 2023. That's across all fishes. We have a lot of name changes, but it's not, once that committee says we all agree and approve these changes, then AFS is the one that publishes the names of the fishes in North America. And this is Fishes of North America.
Okay.
So there are other publications outside of North America, they may be using a different name.
But now, isn't the purpose of these scientific names, these usually Latin or Greek names, isn't the purpose of that, so using these dead languages, so that scientists all around the world will have some consensus on that? And is there potentially any pushback from other places where there are bass? Because the bass, the black bass are one of the most widespread, if not the most widespread freshwater fish in the world.
Yeah. So the title of the actual name book is the common and scientific names of fishes from United States, Canada, and Mexico.
Okay.
The common part is the part that's important to us, because we're going to be talking about largemouth and Florida bass and Alabama bass and spotted bass. The scientific name that's attached to that common name that we use here is attached to a different common name there, but it's still talking about the same species of fish.
Gotcha. Zack, being with IGFA and being in charge of the rule book, I'm sorry, the record book and things like that, and recognition of the anglers who take this record stuff so seriously, this must be simultaneously very exciting and some sort of record-keeping nightmare for you.
You put that perfectly. I mean, for me, obviously, it creates some more work, which I'm more than happy to do. And at the same time, it's super exciting. And to be honest with you, I came to IGFA 3 years ago, and Andrew was already working with us on this project. So I jumped into it halfway through with him. And I've learned such a great deal from him and throughout this entire process about black bass as a whole. If you would have talked to me before, you know, in 2021, when I was in grad school, right in 2020, I wouldn't have known nearly as much as I do now. And from, you know, having been in this position for a while and seeing how records change and also just the excitement behind certain records, I do agree with the sentiment that, you know, right now at this point in time, when it comes to black bass, there's no better time to set a new world record. And for me, that's really exciting, because I know it's going to make an angler somewhere in the world very excited as well. And that's a big part of what I do, kind of, you know, is giving recognition to people for outstanding catches. So, for us to be able to do this, acknowledge these new species and open up these record categories, it's going to be fantastic. And it does come with, you know, its trials and tribulations, but I'm ready to take them on. And I know we are here as well.
I'm excited to get into some of that. First, though, I want to ask all three of you guys a question with regard to some of this stuff. How much of these changes are coming from the drive of a few motivated and serious and dedicated biologist, and how much of it is being driven by advancements in technology, like perhaps DNA testing and things like that?
I would, again, defer to Andrew, but I would say they go hand in hand, I'd have to imagine.
Yeah, I think it's hard to decouple the science from the scientists, right? So. Sure. There is science and we strive for truth, but we're still humans and we still view the world our own unique ways, right? So I think you get a little bit of unique perspective from different scientists that are tackling these questions. And certainly there's still even a little bit of disagreement on, like, maybe where we should draw the line. And there definitely have been a lot of disagreements in the past. With time and with more evidence, we tend to find a closer and closer picture of the truth. But I certainly think the uptick over the last, like, two decades or so has really been the advent of improved genetic methods and lower cost for those methods, to where us lowly fish biologists can actually access that and leverage that for our studies. Yeah, so hopefully that answered your question a little bit.
It did. Dr. Battisti.
So I have a question for you, and it has to do with the basics. And I'm asking it for me to refresh my biology in my head, but I'm also asking it for everybody out that's watching this podcast. Can you go through the basics of naming? Okay, so Micropterus is the genus, and then the name after that is a species, and the name after that is a subspecies. Can you kind of go through an example of how all this works for us, and what fish are related within a species or a subspecies, et cetera? And you don't have to use the black bass if you don't want to.
Yeah, I think I can try that, and maybe Steven and Zach can chime in where I misstep. So it's a great question. Scientific names are called basically a Latin binomial. Binomial meaning you have a genus name first and a species name second. And typically that's it. But in some cases, in some groups of animals, not just fish, we sometimes go down to subspecies. So for black bass, you have actually a genus name that doesn't even really match the fish, actually. It's kind of an erroneous name. It's Micropterus. It means micro, small. Pterus means fin. And it was actually named small fin because the original type specimen that Lacepede, I believe, looked at, he was over in Europe, and he got one shipped over to him from North America. It had a torn dorsal fin. So it looked like it had one small dorsal fin and then the two normal ones we see. And so he named it Micropterus. Because there's these scientific naming precedents, the first name that's valid has to be used. So they're all Micropterus. The name doesn't even make sense. And then the species name is more specific. So we give a lot of times they're kind of descriptive of the place they're from. They can be descriptive of the habitat they live in. Sometimes they're named after other scientists, but more specific to that individual species that we give a common name to as well. And then the subspecies names usually trail after that. We have had subspecies in the black bass genus for, well, probably since about the 40s and 50s. And it was really common to designate subspecies back then. But as we've kind of evolved, as science has evolved and our thoughts on taxonomy have evolved as a whole, not just with fish, but just with zoology in general. We've kind of moved away as scientists from the idea of a subspecies in many groups of animals. And so then it becomes like, well, was it different enough to be elevated to a species, or is it actually not different enough and it should just be lumped back into one? And so that's kind of part of what's happened over the last couple of decades, as we've tackled that question with the black bass. We had a lot of things that we were considering subspecies from work that was done back in the 40s and 50s before genetics, right? And so now we're trying to say, okay, well, given those physical characteristics they found then, now we've got genetic data to kind of back this up or not, right? And then, so there's been a little bit of flux there.
You know, I guess the subspecies that was always resonating the most with me living in Florida was one, I guess, created by Bailey and Hubbs in about 1949, which was, at the time, was Micropterus salmoidis floridanus. And of course, that's now wiped clean. And I think that's going to be the biggest nomenclature headache, it seems, because that fish is now simply Micropterus salmoidis, which used to cover the northern largemouth and the Florida largemouth, but now it just covers what we used to call the Florida bass. Yeah, and I guess we still call it the Florida bass as a common name.
What is cool is you're all coming around the same topic. Andrew brings up the fish that was originally identified and given the name Micropterus salmoides. And then the truth of that fish becomes that now that we look at it, and really Andrew and so many great biologists are the ones doing this work, but now they're looking at that fish and where it came from in the United States to be shipped to Europe to be identified originally, it turns out that fish was most likely a Florida bass. And so that brings us to the name change that's going to start this world record chase, is the fact that we need to now take Micropterus salmoides, and that is the scientific name of Florida bass. And therefore, now we need to take what we would consider largemouth bass across the majority of the U.S., and we need to give them their first scientific name. So they get a new scientific name, and then that brings us to the question that Zach and Andrew are going to be trying to tackle with what does IGFA do with this information?
Yeah, and that the name of what we used to call the northern subspecies, or simply Micropterus salmoides, is now Micropterus nigricans. Is that the pronunciation?
Yeah, that's correct.
I love asking biologists this question.
Some weird, like,
I'm sorry. I love asking biologists
this question because it seems like naming rules.
Yeah. Now that one was picked up in like 1802, right? Initially. Or something like that. That one goes back, you know, hundreds of centuries. And I think it's cool that that kind of respect is paid to history, that those names are not simply forgotten and discarded. You're still acknowledging the work of the biologists more than two centuries ago in trying to identify and create a taxonomy for these fish. And I appreciate that. I think that's wonderful.
So my question is, how do you classify a hybrid, which is what you have the world record as, is a hybrid? They're not a northern, and excuse my, I'm not, you know, in with the in crowd yet. I'm going to still call them by the names that I grew up with them. How do you determine them from a Florida, a northern and a Florida, you know, because it was the Florida northern hybrid that has created all the fish over 20 pounds. And no, Terry.
We have this debate every time I see Terry.
Sorry?
We have this debate every time I see you.
We do.
All fish over 20 pounds are not hybrids. Some of those are pure Floridas, if not
okay,
all
or
of
pure Floridas. Floridas.
But
okay, I will not dispute that. But the thing is that the new record for nigricans is going to be the Kurita fish. Is that what I didn't read in that report?
Yeah, so Terry's skipping to the end, everybody that's watching. It's typical Terry. Don't worry about it. Okay, so whenever the name change happened, something had to happen with the current world record fish. And Andrew and Zach worked on this project, and I'm so excited that they're both here to explain what IGFA's process is historically of whenever there's a name change split, and then what are we going to do with largemouth bass? I think let's not skip to the end, Terry. We're baking a cake here.
Oh, man. BTC.
Brian, can you get us back to the flour and sugar, please?
Flour and sugar. Well, I don't know. Take it from where you were about to go there, Steve.
All right. I'll be the new host. Everybody sit back.
Which one of us are you replacing? Which one of us are you replacing? It's important to know.
We know which one.
Okay. See you, Terry. No.
Hey, guys.
So, Andrew, I think the great place to start would be, how did the relationship come to place where you and Zach were going to work together and create the last article that y'all had published? That one.
Which, by the way, is titled Updating Angling Records to Advance Sport Fish Conservation, a Case Study of IGFA's Black Bass World Records. And guys, how can people get a copy of this?
So it is, unfortunately, because it's a scientific article, it's behind a paywall. Most scientific publishers do that. However, we as authors know that this is really important, and we're starting to do some outreach. We're going to have some podcasts such as yours, but also we're working with some scientific writers and some sports fishing writers to try to get this message out more broadly and explained in a language that, you know, every angler can, you know, digest. But sort of the way this whole thing started for me was, you know, I have my interest in black bass taxonomy, black bass diversity. I do a lot of black bass genetics work to try to figure out what are the status of different populations and things like that. And so, but I'm also a fisherman. That's how I even got into all this to start. Like, I love the outdoors. I became a biologist because I love the outdoors. I fish all the time. And so I also was kind of like, wow, some of these records are maybe misidentified. You know, you start looking at some of the pictures and you're like, well, we know a lot more about bass over the last 20 years than some of these records are fairly old. And we know how to identify them better than ever. So I had that kind of going on in my mind. And then we kind of met through, it was actually a meeting I had with Zach's predecessor about a hybrid gar record that was caught and how IGFA was going to handle this gar record. And somehow we started talking about black bass after that. And I think it was just kind of a natural realization between IGFA and I that, like, it was time. It was time to at least bring all the records out, put them under a microscope, and see where we were at, given that recent understanding of, like, yep, we've got 14 species, and that's what the scientific community is rolling with. It just felt natural. But I know Zach also has a story from his side that kind of is an origin story, too, that's worth yeah, telling. Yeah, of course.
So, obviously, you know, we hold records for game fish from all around the world, right? So I myself as the angler recognition manager, Jason Schrattweiser, our president, you know, Bruce Pollard, our conservation director, we all would, you know, love to deem ourselves experts of all fish, you know, from around the globe, but it's not possible from our side. So we rely heavily on experts within certain fields, right? And black bass being one of them. That's the story that Andrew told. Again, it predated me, but, I can tell you that I believe it was around 2017 or 2018. And this kind of goes to what we were talking, Ken, about in the back room before this. Somebody reached out to the IGFA and said, hey, you know, we'd really appreciate it if you guys would take a look at your spotted bass records. You know, we're looking through, reviewing the bodies of water that they're coming from, and the lot's not adding up, you know, and we do our due diligence across the board when it comes to claims like that, and, you know, and any species. So I, you know, just knowing my predecessor who started working with Andrew and just how, when you're sitting in this chair, how your brain works, right? You know, that hybrid gar situation was one that needed immediate attention, you know, and I guarantee in the back of his head, you know, he had the spotted bass, Alabama bass debate, something he needed to, you know, find the right person to help manage that. And when he met Andrew, and I can, you know, now attest to working with 3 years with Andrew that, you know, he's the right person for that job. So we defer to him to kind of, on a case-by-case basis, review all of these current spotted bass records, line class records specifically, that we have been holding for, you know, since the 1980s. And so when, you know, I had an initial meeting with Andrew, he kind of briefed me on what he needed from us, you know, what I needed to provide to him photo-wise, and we just got to work on it. And over the course of 2 years here, we've, you know, cleaned up, so to speak, our records pages for spotted bass. And that's what started all of this, was, you know, getting to the bottom of the spotted bass, Alabama bass debate. And, you know, not to get off topic again and finish baking the cake, but, you know, a lot of talk is going to be about the Florida bass. And that's, I know that's a hot topic within the community, but what Andrew and I want to really get across here is the issue with spotted bass and Alabama bass hybridization and what's happening to both of those species right now in the country. And then again, the crux of what this paper is what we did together to better reflect the species from a record standpoint, and I think that's really important to kind of get the word across on. And, you know, moving forward as well, we're obviously going to talk about the new vacant all tackle world records for Florida bass, but there are now several vacant line class records, tippet class records, junior records for spotted bass that are open to be set And it's, you know, it's very difficult to find a region in the country right now where you can find a purebred spotted bass. So that's kind of, you know, that's what's really important to us with this whole paper.
Guys, I think one of the challenges I'm having in wrapping my tiny brain around the topic of this show is I'm having a hard time kind of putting it in order so that we can bake the cake. But Zack, you just made a fascinating point that fascinates me no end here. You talked about finding a purebred, you know, Alabama spot versus a Kentucky spot or whatever. Let's talk about that for just a moment. And let's say that somebody wants to enter a fish as a Micropterus salmoides, the new name for Florida bass. And because that spot's going to be open, wide open. What level of genetic purity must that fish have to qualify in that category with IGFA?
For an all tackle record, which would be what is available for salmonoids right now, it would have to be a pure genetic Micropterus salmonoides bass. It couldn't have any differentiation. That's across the board for all of our all tackle records. Interestingly enough, with our line class records too, that's the case as well. And that kind of caused a lot of the issue that started this whole thing, not to backtrack again. But you know, for our spotted bass line class records, this fish needed to be, you know, 100% punctulatus. And with, you know, whether or not there were, you know, total hybridization or 50-50 split with these Alabama bass, depending on what lake or what river system they're in, we can't have that for a line class record because the line class record is set for the species. It's not set for the common name or something, you know, along those lines. So that's the case in all scenarios. The fish needs to be, you know, a pure genetic Micropterus salmonoides. Now, we do also hold hybrid records for fish. We have an Alabama smallmouth hybrid record. We have a largemouth smallmouth hybrid record. Those exist, and those are pure 50-50 splits between those two species from a genetic standpoint.
But let's say somebody catches a giant spotted bass that's a hybrid of the two, whatever, and it's larger than either, but it's not 50-50. Is it even possibly something other than 50-50? It's 75-25 Alabama, let's say. But let's say it exceeds either all tackle world record. Will it go in as a hybrid?
If it exceeds both all tackle world records, it would not go in as a hybrid. It would go in, and this is a situation where I now turn to Steven and Andrew, right? That, so a record comes across my desk. I have a genetics report, and whatever angler is submitting the application, they're you know, claiming this to be a certain species or certain species, and I would take those results. I would turn to Steven or Andrew, and I would say, you know, all right, explain to me what I'm looking at and what you would call this species. And if they're going to say, hey, you know, this isn't a pure, you know, whatever the application, you know, whatever species is applying for, then we can't move forward with that species as a new record.
Are you saying to me that because the fish is a hybrid in this case, and perhaps you don't recognize a hybrid in that category, that it would not have any place at all in the record books?
Yes.
That's where I have a problem. And I don't see a problem in the angling community at large, because quite honestly, what the angling community will do there is the angling community will, by and large, will consider that the world record, irrespective of what the record keeping organizations may do. But I don't want IGFA to lose that political battle in the court of public opinion. I think something needs to be done to address that situation. Because I assure you, if somebody catches a 22 and a half pound largemouth bass of any kind, of either, you know, Salmoides or Nigricanus, that's the freaking world record, gentlemen. No questions asked.
Yep.
Yeah, and I certainly see your point there. And as a fisherman myself, I completely understand where you're coming from. And one thing, you know, me sitting in this chair, we have to set a standard across the board. And the issue there is that, so our records aren't just, you know, black bass records. We have, you know, records across the board for number of saltwater species. So we've set a standard. We have to stick to that standard, stick to our guns, so to speak. We can't waffle on a certain situation. Those are the tough decisions that I have to make, you know, in terms of that's the email I don't want to send, but I have to.
I have
in and that now listen, that may change down the road. I can't speak on that, but as it sits today, that's how I have to approach things.
I have tremendous respect for your organization. I've been a member of IGFA for 30 years. I have every one of your record fish books dating back to when you started keeping freshwater records in 1978. And you guys are the ultimate authority. There are other record keeping organizations out there that I think are pretenders. But there's also a populist element to what you do. Apart from the scientific element and apart from the membership element, there's a populist element to what you do. And I think it would be a serious error not to take that into consideration. And I'm not looking for a comment on that. I'm just saying, I guess that's my,
no, not, that's my red flag. Yeah, I certainly see where you're coming from. And I think that it's definitely open for discussion, debate, like we were talking about earlier. You know, that we our goal here, and it's what we've done with this paper, is to stay as up to date with the fishing, the general fishing population as we can be, and what's changing in both the fishing community and the scientific community. And so things have always shifted and changed within our organization with how we keep records. And again, I can't speak on what's going to happen there, how quickly something would happen, but I certainly see where you're coming from. And as a fisherman myself, I mean, Andrew talked about himself being a fisherman. I that's my passion as well. I mean, yeah, having had multiple conversations with anglers whose records have been rejected for various reasons, there's always that side of the story. And I am more than, akin to, I hear it every single time there's a scenario where, you know, someone's record gets rejected for a specific rule infraction or something that they say, you know, come on, that, you know, that's the record fish. I get where they're coming from 100%. I just, as my job in this chair, I can't say yes. It's almost like being the police in certain situations.
Well, it's really tough. A rules infraction is one thing. When it comes down to, you know, counting scales and, you know, DNA and, I mean, holy mackerel, you got a 23.5-pound bass here that Joe has caught at some pond in Oklahoma. And you're going to tell him because it's not a pure Florida or it's not a pure Northern or however these things are being judged now, that he doesn't have the overall line or the overall record for a largemouth bass. I think that's going to really irritate people.
Go ahead.
Andrew, you got something for us. What you got?
Yeah, so I love catching big bass. We all love catching big bass, right? I mean, part of fishing is seeking a trophy, something you can, you know, be proud of to show your friends, right? And a world record would be like a once in a lifetime, a one in a million kind of fish, right? But I also try to come from this from a conservation standpoint too. We have a lot of species that, believe it or not, black bass, our most popular genus of freshwater sport fish in North America, that are on the brink of potentially like blipping off the face of the earth. And what's gotten us into this mess is we move fish around. We move a lot of fish around. And when they haven't lived in the same system for millions of years, they don't know how to tell each other apart. And in one of the systems I research in Georgia, we've got, sometimes I'm sampling fish that might have the background of four different parental species and one fish. We call them Chattahoochee River mutts, right? It's a balance, right? So on one hand, we want to grow the biggest bass possible. Everyone wants to catch a big bass, but at some point moving fish around because they grow big is actually detrimental to bass conservation as a whole. So I'm going to throw that out there as well. Not saying that what IGFA does is totally independent of my viewpoint as someone who's interested in conservation. But it's not necessarily the best thing to be hybridizing two distinct species just so you get a one-off freak monster fish every once in a while when those genomes are not adapted to that region necessarily.
I certainly wasn't trying to
throw that out there.
Yeah, I certainly wasn't trying to advocate, and I'm sure that Brian and Terry were not either, advocate for bucket biology. We don't want that. No. But a certain amount of hybridization has been happening since the mid-19th century when they put Spencer Fullerton Baird in charge of the national fisheries effort. But more critically, I think as a Florida guy, born, raised, and living here again, the last thing I wish that ever happened was that Florida bass ever got transplanted out of our state, because then we would own every record.
Wait, Terry, let's talk about the records real quick. This is an image from the paper that Andrew and Jack did, and it shows us basically the seven species that had records prior to 2023. And we can kind of go down this list if we want to. We can talk about some of those conservation species. We can talk about Florida's, Alabama's, and spots, and look at what the record was, what it's going to be revised to, and where the opportunities are for anglers across all of these.
Yes. This is what gets me excited. And obviously the previous topic is contentious. For me, on the other side of things, I think this is a great opportunity for anglers out there to achieve an IGFA world record. And that's why I do what I do. That's what gets me excited. So just kind of to go down the list here, and it seems confusing the way, you know, looking at it, it's a lot of information, but it's really simple, the process that's happened here, right? So kind of what we were talking about earlier, I identify and accept an IGFA all tackle world record for any recognized species anywhere in the world that weighs at least 1 pound. That's the minimum weight requirement. So now whether that's, you know, a black bass species as it's listed here, or whether that's a species of unicorn filefish from Japan, if it's a recognized scientific species, it weighs, you know, 1 pound, 0 ounces, we'll accept it as a new world record. So what had happened here was these species went from, you know, not being recognized, being subspecies, to being recognized as their own individual species. As soon as that happens scientifically, regardless of whether I open up a record, so to speak, the record is open and available. You know, if that paper was released, you know, the very next day someone submitted a record from one of those four species here that were elevated, then that would have been the new all-tack world record. So those are open and available. Obviously, the one that everyone is excited about is the Florida bass record. I don't know, because they haven't followed up with me yet, but I received word from Texas about 2-3 weeks ago that someone caught a fish that genetically tested out to be a Florida bass, and they were planning on submitting it. I certified a scale for them. I haven't heard anything since then, so I guess that's out in the open right now. I don't know if maybe they had a rule infraction that they didn't know about. So that's one. And then
Zach, I want to come right back to you on this, but Steven, this is my concern, is that this is Texas's sad little ploy to have a world record bass.
Well, you know, this is exactly what happened. This is exactly what happened. I paid Andrew, I paid Zach, so make sure we bring the record home. No, that's not what happened, Ken. Let's talk about the largemouth record. Let's talk about the actual possible Perry fish.
I definitely want to do that, but Zach, I apologize for.
No worries at all.
You there. Let's get back to Zach, because you and I are going to have it out, Steven. We're going to have it out.
Okay, brother.
No.
So I can wrap that up real quick. So, I mean, those new species that are recognized are now available for all tackle records, right? And then the other opportunities that are currently, open and available that as a result of this paper that we did are spotted bass records. Now, Andrew can attest, because I've sent him multiple photos in the past, you know, couple months here of people that are trying to set those records. As a result of this paper, us determining that the majority of these lakes and rivers are more than likely filled with Henshali, Alabama bass, it's tough to find a true purebred spotted bass. But I did receive applications from, and you're going to hate this one, Ken, but from Texas, from the Trinity River, for two new records for spotted bass. Me as the angler recognition manager, again, and I said this a little earlier, you know, there's this viewpoint that, from the angling community, that the IGFA, me specifically, I'm out there to, you know, find whatever small detail I can to reject your record. And that's not the case. I work every single day to get people, you know, into world records. It's what I love to do. So I've been telling everyone that calls and asks, you know, where do I need to go to get some spotted bass records? And I have to tell them, you know, as of right now, the safest place to try and do something like that is going to be Texas. So that's my pitch to the angling community. If you're in the region,
The line class records, you can check them out, igfa.org. You know, use our world record database, pull up the spotted bass page. There's opportunities available for women, junior records. They're going to be set here over the course of the next year or two. So this is your chance to go out and get one for yourself.
Let's get a plug in for IGFA. Folks, you need to go to igfa.org and get a membership. I've been a member for 30 odd years. There's not only are you entitled then to get a hard copy of the record book, which is terrific, a lot of good articles in addition to all the records, but there's also a terrific periodic newsletter to keep you up to speed on what's going on in the world of record class fish. And Zack, I'd like to thank you for bringing up what is obviously a racketeering effort in the state of Texas. I will not rest until arrests are made. I'm not sure how Steven Bardin is in charge of this and is running this corrupt organization, but I'm sure there's a means behind there somehow.
You may find this interesting, but this is the first time we've ever met. So me and Steven.
Well, that doesn't
mean... You mean met in person or via...
Zack, perhaps you've heard of Kaiser Sose.
Oh, exactly. All right.
or good intel agents.
All right, Steven, where were you going with this whole George Perry world record largemouth thing?
Well,
because Andrew, I want you to know in advance that both Terry and I are major advocates of the proposition that George Perry is a total fraud. But go ahead, Steven.
I'm also in your camp, but I'm more interested in discussing in the paper. They do discuss the location in which the Perry fish was allegedly caught and how that would most likely fall into a Florida genetic native home range. Therefore, the Perry fish would most likely be a Florida largemouth. And yet...
Not 100% certain.
Not 100% certain.
Which is what Zack said a little while ago, was that you had to be 100% certain.
Right, but we're not 100% certain it's a largemouth bass either.
Well, and let's get real practical here. Zack knows very well that if you DQ Perry and Carita from either of those categories, that the bass community is going to go berserk, and no longer even know how to spell IGFA, care about the records.
I think we could probably. We could probably figure out the Carita fish much easier than we could the Perry fish. It pictures exist. So
we did look into both, you know, assuming that the Perry fish is legitimate because it is on the record book. We looked into both. We looked at the range. We looked at, you know, existing genetic data from both of those areas. The George Perry fish, I'm really familiar with that area. Lower Okmulgee, it's an oxbow. It was an oxbow off the Okmulgee River. Our sampling for that earlier paper I was talking about shows that it would have been a more Florida bass background genetically, but it also, that part of the river sits on a really prominent geological feature known as the fall line. And above the fall line, like upstream of there, is mostly largemouth bass. And just downstream was that oxbow. And downstream is mostly Florida bass. But it's kind of a natural zone where you kind of get a little bit of a natural intermixing. And so, yeah, even though probably that fish did have Florida bass, I mean, to get that big, you would think it would have had to have at least some Florida bass.
From my
standpoint, I was more interested in it from academics, right? And then
sure.
We then brought that information to Zack, and you know, we had to kind of figure out, well, what would IGFA do in these cases? But the other fish, the Kurita fish in Japan, you know, no micropters are native to Japan, right?
No.
So right. They brought over largemouth bass at one point.
At 1925, they were initially stocked. In 1980, they took over Florida's. And
Yep. And I found some papers that, you know, they didn't include the Kurita fish in their genetics, but there are papers that show in that system, Lake Biwa, it was a northern, you know, traditional largemouth bass population. And around the time those giant freaks were caught would have been around the time that the genome was switching over to mostly Florida bass genes, or there could have been hybrids. And so on that one, there were good pictures. We did do some scale counts that would have maybe leaned it a little bit towards Florida bass, actually, right? Which makes sense because we all know Florida grass have a top end size bigger than largemouth. But that's part of why this distinction is so important, right? It's like we're recognizing that, you know, all these fish grow to a different maximum size. They all have different different growth histories and different ecologies, for that matter. You catch them in different types of habitats. But yeah, so what we do with that information, though, it kind of comes down to like IGFA's precedence, right? Because if it's not definitive, then it's kind of like a little bit of a gray area to me, right? And to me, as the person who's trying to taxonomically evaluate, I've counted scales on, gosh, thousands of bass now. Way more. I've seen way more scales. I've seen way more scales than I have scales etched into my eyelids when I try to sleep at night. I've counted so many. But you can't be sure. Usually all these fish have a range, right? It's not like they're always going to be 75 lateral line scales. No, it's like there's a range of error there. And sometimes there's a little overlap. And so you can't always be sure from just counting one or two things, especially when you know there's been mixing. Yeah. So then that kind of led into like conversations with IGFA and Zach's side of things.
Okay. But you're saying a lot of things that really interest me here, Andrew. You're telling me that, yeah, we know Florida bass have a greater propensity and a greater top end growth than what we used to just call northern largemouths. And you're telling me, yeah, this the perryfish apparently came from an area where pure Floridas were in their native range. And the Carita fish was coming at a time when the pure Florida genetics were in place. And yet, that's not what you guys have decided to call the fish. You decided to call it the other.
Yeah, so now we're in a situation where if we look at that table, we see that largemouth bass is now going to be open. Largemouth bass is now going to be the 22-pound 4-ounce fish. And so it will not be broken again.
All right, so the Florida
is open. Will be open.
So Florida and Northern is not. Again, you're
but then
I get that.
It's backwards. Yeah, it's backwards.
Why?
It feels backwards, right?
Yes.
It's totally backwards.
Yes.
But from our perspective, from the IGFA perspective, we can't adjust records that are approved and set in place without definitive proof. Not if all signs point in a certain direction, that's one thing, but it has to be 100% definitive proof. And so that's the reason why these records are being grandfathered over into Negro cans, because at the time of their approval, from a scientific perspective, that was the recognized genus and species for the fish that was caught. So that's the case we have.
Hold on, Zach, but you didn't do the same thing for spotted bass and Alabama bass.
With regards to?
Well, because the Alabama bass was the spotted bass record. And so at the time, that was genetically considered the same species. But then when you split them, you did the right thing and you took the Alabama bass record and put it where it was, because a fish from California was an Alabama bass. We can say that. But we don't have a sample of that specific fish to say that specific fish was.
But hold on. There is a really important distinguishing set of criteria there between those two scenarios. So in both of the scenarios with the largemouth bass and the Florida bass, you have situations where there was either natural mixing possible, or we know from the few genetic studies in that system at Lake Biwa that there was genetic mixing, right? There was a period of flux. What we know with those fish in California, we not only do we have the meristics and really good pictures, which is awesome, because I love looking at scales on fish. we have state stocking records, and we know that these fish are Alabama bass. They're sourced Alabama bass. brought over. There's a really established history. The state of California, they shared all their stocking records with us. It was great. Lake Paris was one of the original destinations for those fish. They had a few freak huge fish, right? And Bullard's Bar and all those eventually got Alabama bass. And I think people out in California don't even know it's an Alabama bass. And that's kind of one of the issues. And one of the things that I hope that some of this work brings to light is Alabama bass are not spotted bass. A huge spotted bass tops out. They're like little footballs, maybe like 3.5-4 pounds is a huge spotted bass. That's nothing to an Alabama bass. I catch Alabama bass that size every other float trip. I mean, they're not, that's not big for an Alabama bass. Alabama bass are big. Alabama bass are like, you know, 6 pounds, 7 pounds. And of course, then you get freaks like that one out in California, but totally different growth potential again, and totally different ecologies.
Right. And so now with the largemouth bass being retained, the world record being retained at 22 pounds, we could almost guarantee as fisheries managers that we're not going to break that largemouth bass record again, because we can't use Florida genetic with that. So that record stands forever.
And what is, in my eyes, it's biologically wrong because it's got Florida genes in it. Every in one of those eyes, fish have Florida genes.
Probably. Almost certainly. Certainly, right. It's against the preponderance of the evidence. Now so I used to be a lawyer. You guys are biologists, I'm a lawyer. We're coming at this from wildly different directions.
So what is the biggest natural northern that has ever been documented?
Thank you.
And I would defer to Andrew and Steve on that in terms of pure northern. I mean, I can look through our record books into locations of where our largemouth bass records have been caught, but I don't know if you guys, I haven't done that in the past. Have you guys know off the top of your head?
Well, if you,
you know, this is actually,
records. Go ahead.
I was going to say, you know, that's Terry, that's a great question. Since we've done all these taxonomic revisions, we've literally even learned that the ranges we thought Florida bass was in was wrong. We don't have new updated calibrated growth curves for what a pure largemouth top end growth is. We would only have anecdotal. As far as I know, there's been no paper that's kind of adjusted for that. So we would only have our own like angling anecdotes to go off of there.
Well, you could look at some state records and make some estimations or educated guesses, but you don't know what the bucket biology history might be. Like, for example, yeah. Virginia has a state record that's, I think, 16 and a quarter. Of course, Massachusetts has a state record that's 15 and a half, which, you know, we don't have any way to check the genetics on that. But if that were a legit fish, you'd have to say that's in the neighborhood of the biggest northern largemouth.
If you take California record, the California record that was caught in 1940 that lasted until the Orville Ball experiment was 14 pounds even, and it came out of a trout stock lake and up in Northern California. And I'm pretty dang sure that that was a northern strain, or what you guys are calling a largemouth bass these days.
Right. So, and if you take all the Great Lakes states and you look at their average state record, you're talking 12 pounds. Yeah, so the answer is somewhere between 12 and 15 pounds. That's where it is.
Yep.
So we now have a 22 pound record. We have a 10 pound delta that we're not going to overcome.
So you guys are okay with the fact that you've just established a world record that is perhaps 6-7 pounds out of reach. And that's okay?
I'm not necessarily saying that's okay, Ken. I'm saying that's the precedent that we have set in previous situations with other species when we've made adjustments like this. And to fall in line with that, it's what we've had to done. We've had to do moving forward with this species as well. Now, I mentioned to you earlier too, we talked about, there's certainly a case to be made, right? We talked about it here at length, and we are open to listening to the angling community. It's something that we pride ourselves on around here too. And we talk about this in the pre-show. I mean, you certainly, if you could file a formal protest on any existing record that we have, and with enough evidence to back it, and you know, we would lean towards Andrew and Steven and Black Bass Experts to help us adjust and you know, change any decisions we have moving forward with enough evidence behind it.
I take you at your word, Jack. Zach, I believe you. I know IGFA wants to do the right thing, but to wait on a panel of anglers to come out and try to challenge that, we all know that's not going to happen, because nobody thinks about a world record until they've got it on the back and they threw it on a scale.
It's certainly understandable. And this is all happening, you know, live and new in the last year or so. In the scientific community world, that's not a lot of time in terms of when this is made. So, you know, for us as an organization, I feel like I'm a broken record at this point, but we just had to maintain the precedence that we've set. Now, if that's going to shift and adjust in the future as science shifts and adjusts, that may be the case. But in terms of this paper specifically that Andrew and I wrote, you know, as we went down the list and checked off certain species and reviewed everything, it's almost standard operating procedure how we've kind of divvied everything out.
And I think that one cool thing about what Zach's saying is, by making this standard operating procedure, it opened up a huge opportunity, one that we haven't really got to touch on, which is Florida bass is now open. And like Zach said, the great state of Texas with the Sher Lunker program, the genetics that we do, we know exactly what all these above 13-pound fish caught this year, what their genetic profiles are, and we'll go ahead and take that world record now.
I was going to add too to this discussion, just trying to think, like, not an IGFA hat on, but just an angling, like thinking about how those records would change, what the ramifications would be, right? We entertain this idea of like, maybe those fish should move to Florida bass. Then you have a lot of people catching what they think are largemouth bass that are not, that are really big hybrids of some sort, right? And so that's a whole nother issue that's kind of very big and untenable and kind of on shaky ground. So I mean, I certainly think that IGFA has strong grounds based on the lack of data, based on the lack of definitive data, that they should just be grandfathered in as largemouth bass. There really has to be a winner and a loser. You have to kind of make a decision. One's going to be open and one's going to be nearly unattainable either way, right? People who catch Florida bass, yeah, you catch 10, 12-pound Florida bass. Very rarely do you ever see them getting up and even within a few pounds of that world record size, right? So, I mean, we're still talking about a rare event there.
And to add on to what Steven's saying, in terms of this being an exciting opportunity, right, with this Florida bass record opening up, you know, if you look back at our, you know, history over the course of the last 20 or so years, as an organization, we've added new species for line class records, which what we consider game fish. Now, I even don't necessarily think that's a fair term, because, you know, what makes one fish more of a game fish than another? But it's the term we use to set species for line class records. Now, that's a process that's run through our board of trustees, our executive committees, our rules and recognition committees. So it's a process that needs to be voted on, right? The precedent is set, and I keep using that term, to add new species, right? So if we get an all tackle record for Florida bass, which I know we will here in the very near future, and you know, that the angling community, and kind of what me and Andrew are really trying to get across here, is these properly identifying the fish you're catching, the region you're catching them in, and understanding, you know, where certain species of bass are moving around to. If that species is open up for a line class record, which certainly could be the case moving forward in a couple of years here, that's going to be even more record opportunities too for that region and that species. And the same may be done for Alabama bass based off the results of this paper. That may be something that may be even happening sooner rather than later over the course of the next few years here.
I want to be on record here as just saying to you guys, I appreciate all the work that's gone into this, all the thought that's gone into it. But I think there might, I hope at some point there's room to consider integrates. I'm not sure if that's the right phrase. Integrates, the crossbreeding of two different species. And Steven, I'm going to throw one at you here. The kings of recognizing those integrates is the state of Texas. The state of Texas recognizes more black bass record classifications than anybody, including multiple cross between a spot and a smallmouth and stuff like that. Maybe that's part of a process that could be recognized here. And Steven, I know you've talked with some different state agencies about how they might handle this situation. Can you give us a feel for what some of the state agencies might do?
Yeah, so I am extremely lucky because of my work with Major League Fishing that I have access to a lot of black bass biologists, fish chiefs, regional biologists. And so I just sent the message out. Looks like we're going to have some IGFA records open up. What are we going to do within your state? And truthfully, Ken, across the board, there is no defined answer. Some states are going to fall in line and they're going to do state records just like IGFA is doing them. Other states are going to keep bass lumped together to where we have spotted bass, largemouth bass records, smallmouth bass records. They're not going to divide them out because genetically, as Andrew would probably point out, this is a process that would take time to correctly identify these fish. And then there are states like Texas that see this as a big opportunity. This is an opportunity to highlight the fact that we do have specific genetic stocking programs within our state that are targeted to grow trophy size fish. At the end of the day, whenever we work in the sport fish realm, we work for anglers and we're trying to make fisheries better. Sometimes that means providing specific opportunities for genetically distinct individuals, and sometimes that's trophy fish. But the state agencies themselves, there's no definitive answer on what they're going to do. Every state's going to take this as a case-by-case basis, depending on what their bandwidth is in their own genetic labs, what opportunities exist in their fisheries. And yeah, they do trust IGFA and follow their lead. But at the end of the day, it's a big task to try to identify these different genetic lineages and assign, records.
How come the smallmouth don't have this problem?
Oh, they do, Andrew. Why don't you tell us about smallmouth?
Yeah, I do a lot of research on smallmouth. And so smallmouth have, again, it's the whole subspecies story with largemouth bass and Florida bass all over again on the smallmouth bass side. So that top right panel there, smallmouth bass, very wide ranging. But there's now what we're kind of calling species complexes. So for smallmouth bass, we have now elevated a Neosho bass that lives in the Ozarks. There's that dark blue. And also a Little River and a Ouachita bass that live down in the Ouachita Mountains. And similar problems. Ecologically, these are very different fish. Visually, they look kind of similar because they're close relatives. They all kind of, if you look at it from like an evolutionary standpoint, they're more related to each other than they are to like a largemouth bass or something like that, right? Which makes sense. They all kind of look more similar. But ecologically, they're very different. You can catch smallmouth bass. Every angler knows this. You can catch smallmouth bass in lakes. You can catch smallmouth bass in big rivers and fairly small streams. Neosho bass, lakes aren't really natural in the Ozarks, but we've built lots of lakes in the Ozarks, really good fishing lakes in the Ozarks, like Lake Ten Killer, for example. When we built that dam and flooded that, we're like, this is going to be a great smallmouth fishery. Our native smallmouth are just going to take right into that fishery. But they never did. Because they're a stream-dwelling fish, they're ecologically not a smallmouth bass. They never took to the lake. And so the state agencies are like, well, we need a smallmouth bass fishery. So let's go to Tennessee where they do live in lakes and they grow to good size and they moved them over, which is great. The fishing's good. They grow big, but they've also nearly hybridized the native Neosho bass out of existence. And so that's You know, for me, I come at this from a conservation standpoint. I love catching big fish as an angler, but it's also really sad to see some of these species that have pretty narrow little spots on these maps are actually threatened with extinction in the not so distant future because of moving fish around.
What's so ecologically different about them?
Sorry, say what?
What's ecologically different between the two? The ocean bass and smallmouth.
Yeah. So ecologically, smallmouth bass live in lakes. Neosho bass, when we built lakes, they never took to the lakes. They only live in streams. Their growth potential, vastly different. In the rivers where, in the Ozark rivers where Neosho are native and smallmouth bass have been introduced, you talk to people who kind of like the old timer anglers, right? That can tell you how fisheries have changed. They'll say, oh, the bass used to be, you know, all about a pound and a half. And they had these white bellies and these golden blotches. And now they're way bigger and they have these really dark bellies and they eat totally different things. And we catch them in different sections of the river. I'm like, yeah, cause they're different fish. They're literally different species of fish. They look similar, yes. In fact, the Neosho, we're in the middle of doing some age and growth studies on Neosho with some of my grad students. One grad student, Kobe White, he did a great job on this, and we looked at the growth of Neosho compared to smallmouth bass. Neosho bass only live about 5 years before they die. Smallmouth bass in that same area where they've been introduced, we've got them at least to like 12, 13 years old. So over double the lifespan and way, way, way different top end size. The biggest pure Neosho we find are, I would say maybe about a pound and a half in weight. Some of these, you know, when we all know what a smallmouth bass growth potential is, especially Tennessee strain, I mean, there's people catching like maybe 5-6 pound fish in those same rivers now. Totally different fish, but they look similar, right?
Yeah. So here's, you know, something, Brian, you know, it's like these fish probably need moving water during spawning. You know, maybe their eggs need a lot more oxygen than a smallmouth. A smallmouth can breed in a lake and it's not a problem because of that, but the Neosho can't because it just needs more oxygen, less silt, and that type of thing.
Jerry, that's right. But the thing is, some of these are so new to us, we don't even really know exactly how all they're different and what all they need.
You know, right. I mean, they top out at a pound. It sounded like they needed some help.
In a lot of parts of the country, we call those Neosho bass stripers. But that's another show.
So I have a question regarding this conservation deal. Okay, so let's say you have this Neosho bass that is in one little part of the Arkansas area, and there's only this one stream that has, you know, 20,000 fish in it, and they're the only 20,000 fish in nature. What's going to happen? Are you guys going to shut down that river to fishing because that fish is now considered endangered?
Who's
going to nobody shut it on down? This call can shut it down.
Not it. No. Yeah. No. 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 But that no is one something. Is.
I mean, that's the reality.
Because you said you know, they may be on the brink of extinction.
Right, and some of them, I believe, our science shows some of them are threatened with extinction in the next, maybe in the next 50 years. Because we've moved all these non-natives around, and within several generations, you have almost complete genetic replacement. These narrow ranged endemics, like the Neosho bass, like we saw that map, there were all these headwater dependent species that live in these small streams, like that lower right panel. We call that the red eye bass complex. A lot of them are like, yeah, they have one or two river systems to their name and that's it. We're not in a situation where there's only a couple thousand of them left or anything like that. but it's kind of a scenario where it's death by a thousand cuts. So we have non-natives being moved in. They're hybridizing and competing for the same resources. We have habitat alteration. So for example, there in Georgia, we have several of these unique species. Atlanta continues to sprawl, right? And so humans leave a footprint on these systems. Lots of little things, and it adds up. And the thing is, bass are pretty robust critters, especially when we start looking at like largemouth bass. I know some fish biologists, they joke that they're like ditch pickles. They can live anywhere. When you start to see bass declining, it's a symptom of much, much bigger problems with just our freshwater systems in general. Bass diversity, you can see it's really, really concentrated. We have all these unique species. They're in the southeastern U.S. The southeastern U.S. for freshwater fish, like overall, not just bass, but just freshwater fish overall, is like a mini Amazon. We have like our freshwater fish diversity is second only to the Amazon river system. Like, wow. We have so much to be fighting for. And if we can learn about some of these unique little bass species that only live in one or two systems, and we can come to appreciate them, we can advocate for them, but we can also advocate for all the other fish that they coincide with. Like, we're talking like 300 or more freshwater fish that call those same streams home.
BTC, I think you had something.
I was thinking I wanted to get back to Steve and see, I believe he talked to some different states this week. Is that correct, Steve? See what different fisheries in the individual states, how they're going to handle this.
Yeah, and you know, I don't want to put any specific state on blast.
Come on.
No, nobody from New Jersey to the phone call. Don't worry about it.
I believe that.
No, so really I focused on the states that had either the potential to have a new Florida bass record, states that are either stalking Florida bass or fall in that range. And then I focused on some of those states that maybe are using like the F1 hybrids. You know, they're putting in fish that kind of cross that largemouth Florida bass boundary in that 50%. But like I said earlier, it's not universal, BTC. It seems like every state is going to take this very slow. They're not going to open their record books up quick. Like the IGFA maybe is going to allow us to crown a new Florida bass this year. It seems like the states are going to lag behind, and they're going to want genetic verification. And I think that also becomes an interesting topic because, you know, we have to have a certified scale. We have rules. IGFA, you guys have rules, right? We have to have a certified scale. So what kind of genetic verification are we going to accept? You know, whose labs, how do they submit a sample?
Who pays for it?
Can we go back and pull a sample off of a skin mount from 1930 and 1940 and try to get a genetic sample?
Yes, let's do that.
That sounds like you guys want to watch the world burn.
just one fish. Just one fish of which there is no skin mount. There is no legitimate picture. There is no nothing. So we're not going to live that dream, unfortunately, Zach. But and to go back to your comment, Stephen, you know, who pays for this testing if it's necessary? Because I'm sure the states don't want to pay for it. They're strapped as it is. I expect IGFA does not want to be paying for genetic testing because they get so many applications each year that would be burdensome for them. This is quite the Pandora's box on a lot of levels.
Mm-hmm. I'd argue that we're all venturing kind of into this new world together, so to speak, all different age state agencies, the IGFA, the anglers. I will say, though, it's typically, if I'm going to get a record, more than likely it will be a state record first and foremost. And that is kind of what we've seen recently in the past couple, 5 or 6 years. All hybrid records I've seen, at least in my time here, have been passed on to me by the state, not even the angler. So they've said, you know, we verify that this is our current state record. Here's the results of the genetic study that we ran to verify this is our current state record. It will also be a world record, you know, let us know what you need from us from the to get from the angler. So in most cases, at least, and which is, I don't want to sound like a cop out on our side, but in most cases, that work is going to get done by the state before it comes to us. So I would say that's where we're at now, at least. But again, that still leads to the questions that you just asked.
So Zack, does that put us in a place where a state like Texas that has an existing state record, largemouth bass, that we might have genetic sample of, or a state like California that has existing largemouth bass state records, and we know they're Florida bass, does that mean that that state could retroactively submit that fish and it be the new world record?
So what I will say is there's no time limit to submit a claim for an all tackle world record. Now, for a line class record or a tippet class record, it's 60 days from within the states, 90 days from outside of the U.S. But with that being said, we would still need all of the proper IGFA related documentation to approve a record, right? So if that fish was caught in 1974 or whatever, and you happen to have those genetic studies, if you could provide me with the scale certification, the line sample, the hook, I could move forward with it. It's never happened in terms of something going back that far. I have received records that are 3-4 years old, you know, where someone just didn't get around, or, you know, they didn't know it was a world record, but they happen to have everything saved. So if that is the case, I mean, if we can prove it, there's no time limit on a claim for an all tackle record. But, you know, you'd highly doubt that someone would have maintained all of the required documentation at that time to be approved as a world record.
No, Zack, so you just missed Ken sides. And Terry, though. Ken and Terry have this stuff. It's
behind us. We'll have the Zimmerli fish to you by Tuesday.
That's fantastic.
But all this raises another great question in my mind anyway. And that has to do with all these new species and potentially as many as five or more new ones beyond this in another few years. How many of these species is it going to be relatively easy for an avid angler to identify them strictly by eye, strictly without doing a scale count or having a DNA test? Or is there so much overlap that a DNA test is going to be necessary for any record-keeping organization?
I could start, but I definitely think Steven and Zack could weigh in too. So a lot of the states that have these hot spots of diversity naturally, they're already doing a great amount of work to develop the genetic tools they need to tell what's what and what's where. We have a pretty good grip on that right now. The problem is anglers are continuing to illegally move fish around.
Oh yeah.
And so, especially with like Alabama bass, you see a lot of state agencies are saying like, we have a serious problem here. We've watched Alabama bass go from where they're native, which is basically Northwest Georgia into Alabama, to South Carolina, North Carolina, Tennessee, and even up now into Virginia. And so even Kentucky and some of these other neighboring states are like bracing for impact. It's becoming an unwieldy situation, but it's by humans doing. Like if we didn't have all these fish being artificially moved around, it would be very, very easy to be like, oh, you're fishing in this system. Well, here's your two options. Oh, and this one has red fins. Oh, it's this, right? It's very easy when things are in their natural state. When we start moving stuff, I mean, like I mentioned earlier, Chattahoochee River fish, I've got fish that I look at and I'm like, what the heck is this? And it comes back genetically with four different species in it. That's a mess, right? And I don't think we as anglers, like I try to put on my angling hat because I love to fish too. I don't want to be catching those. I want to be catching the things that belong there, like a shoal bass, like a really cool, unique fish that belongs there, not some, you know, freakazoid fish, genetic mutant fish.
Yeah, four different species. That sounds awkwardly like the Battisti family tree, but we don't need to go there.
Is there a problem with that? It's not inbred like your family tree, which is just a trunk.
Hey, half my family's from Alabama. Some of that's inevitable. But it sounds like some of these species are so close to the eye of even an avid angler that there's no real telling them apart. And that's going to present a lot of challenges. And I wonder if that's going to have a chilling effect on record applications, just because people say, well, you know, there's probably only a 10% chance this is even what I hope it is. One thing that when Steven, you mentioned having talked to some state agencies and stuff like that, and naturally you get different reports from each state because everybody's going to do it a little bit differently, unfortunately. One thing Florida and a couple of other states do with regard to their bass records is if they have a really old bass record that has kind of stood the test of time, but they realize would not hold muster based upon modern standards of authentication, they will classify it as a legacy record, or in the case of how they do it in Florida, they call the Fritz Friebel fish from 1923 the uncertified record. I wonder if some states might go that route. And I think that's not unreasonable. And I would almost encourage IGFA to consider something like that, especially in a case like, for example, George Perry, who, earlier we had Andrew explaining about the fall line near the Okmulgee River. And fall, in that case, stands for anybody who believes a 22-pounder came from there will fall for anything. But I don't think that was the point he was trying to make.
Hey, put that bad comment.
Oh, snap. He was sitting on that one for like 45 minutes.
I am looped out of my mind on cold meds, gentlemen. I'm not responsible for anything I say.
We need you on the Robitussin every episode.
Exactly.
I think to your point, though, Ken, one other distinction that we may make is if we really look at the Perry fish and the Creta fish and we say, well, they may have had Florida influence and most likely had Florida influence, it might be the opportunity to open up that hybrid record where you say that is a largemouth Florida hybrid, and then you would have dual races where we could possibly get a new largemouth and a new Florida record. That would be opportunity that would light the fishing industry on fire.
I mean, that would be, in my opinion, the most honest thing to do, because how can you put a fish that's got Florida genes into a record slot that isn't supposed to?
Then one other thing, Andrew mentioned the shoal bass, and I think that there's a cool opportunity with shoal bass and red eye bass, because those records are also vacated based on Andrew and Zach's research. So do y'all want to touch on those?
Yes, please. Andrew, go ahead.
Yeah.
Go ahead, guys.
Shoal bass have a special place in my heart. They were the first fish I caught in moving water. And a lot of these little narrow-ranged endemic fish, they like moving water. You fish for largemouth bass in a river, you got to find the slack water behind a log or something. Shoal bass, you're in the middle of waterfall, like straight up cascading water. The places you got to go to get them, challenging, beautiful, and they fight like one other. And they get big. For a river fish, they get big. The previous record recognized by IGFA was 8 pounds, 12 ounces. I know so many anglers that got so stinking close. And then we started looking at these records, and it's kind of like we just didn't really know what the identifying characteristics were back then when these species were so new. But we got a few really good convincing pictures of this fish, and it was not a shoal bass at all. It was actually a largemouth intergrade Florida bass of that sort.
Wow.
Shoal bass, if you've seen them, they kind of look a little bit like a smallmouth bass. They have these vivid tiger stripes that go down the length of the body. It was just very clearly, based on all evidence, it was just the wrong identification. So it vacated. So that means I have personal friends that have caught fish shoal bass right around 8 pounds. But they weren't 8 pounds, 12 ounces. So they never even submitted them, right? Because they knew they were close, but it was no cigar. And I think a big shoal bass record, I mean, that's going to happen maybe this spring. I mean, it's right about time that somebody could be running into the next record there.
I've been encouraging Andrew to go set it himself. If anyone should have that record, it should be the guy that made it possible.
That's a little bit of a conflict of interest, but maybe that's my out for not being a good fisherman anymore.
No, I would applaud if you had the record. I want to go back to Zack. Zack, we interrupted you. We got sidetracked, as almost never happens on this show. But you were telling us about some of the open records, and that is really exciting. And I think that's how we kind of baited a lot of folks into watching this show, because everybody would love to have a world record. Everybody would dreams of having a world record. Tell us about some of the opportunities that exist now that didn't exist just 12 months ago.
Sure. And I'd also love if you guys would allow to touch on kind of like, you know, what is necessarily required from us to submit a world record application. Cause I feel like that's important for anglers listening as well too, to kind of have the knowledge when they're going to the lake, when they're going to the river. Like, you know, if I do come across this fish, you know, I happen to be watching this podcast and know that it's available. Well, what do I do? So kind of just to start back, just to list them off, we have those four kind of smaller species that Andrew mentioned that are found sort of regionally centric in those, you know, two or three river systems in, you know, Georgia, Alabama. But obviously, you know, the big names, which we've gone over here, Florida bass being open and available, shoal bass being open, and several spotted bass line class records being open and available now because of this paper. What you would need as an angler from a fishing standpoint. So you catch this fish, let's say you decided to travel to Texas, because that seems to be where we've determined all these records are going to be caught at. You know, you're fishing. There's a couple, you know, and I apologies on my side being the IGFA guy. I know you guys are the bass experts, and we have some rules that, you know, necessarily kind of, you know, you guys, you know, don't tend to follow with terms like lure design, right? So I have multiple records submitted to me that are caught on Alabama rigs with, you know, five hooks. That's something that you can't use if you're fishing IGFA. You can only have, you know, one lure containing hooks at any point in time. So that's something to keep in the back of your head if what you're chasing after is a record. And then the certified scale is kind of something that gets people, you know, hung up. So the scale doesn't necessarily have to be certified at the time that you caught the fish or weighed the fish on that scale. It needs to be certified, you know, immediately after. We certify scales. I certify scales here in my office up to 100 pounds. So let's say you have, you know, your Rapala, or, you know, I don't know if we have any product placement on this podcast, but whatever scale you tend to use. If you weigh that, that's your scale. It's been in your tackle box for 5 years, and it's just something you got one day while you're at the store. You know, you weigh that fish, you get a weight on that scale. You know, you take a picture of the weight on that scale. You can send it in to me with a record application. I can certify that scale here. Obviously, you're taking a risk. You know, you don't know whether that scale is going to pass certification. Now, you can get your scale certified beforehand. It doesn't also have to be done by us, the IGFA. You know, we accept scales certified by any legitimate organization or state. As long as you have a certification documentation and a date within the year of the date of catch, that's what we look for. And then another thing that people get a little hung up on too is you have to, you know, you keep your tackle that you're using to catch that fish and submit it to us. So what we require is a photo of the lure that's being used. If you're using a hook, let's say you're fishing a worm and you're using a hook, you keep that hook tied to your leader. And then you need to submit your hook, leader, and about 15 to 20 feet of your main line. What gets people hung up a lot too is they'll use, let's say, fluorocarbon. And again, apologies if I'm speaking from a bass fishing perspective, but they'll use, you know, like top shots of fluorocarbon, right? So we consider the line class that you're using to be the first 5 meters or 16 and a half feet of line following either your leader or the hook or the lure. So let's say you're running a 20 foot top shot, a 10 pound, you know, fluorocarbon, that's your line class at that point. It's not the braid that you have in on your backing. It's that top shot, as long as it meets that minimum length requirement. So I've had an angler, we actually had an angler from Texas, a female angler, catch a fish last year. She was using, you know, top shot of 10 pound fluoro. It tested at around, I believe, 11 pounds or so. And it was, you know, still within range for the 12 pound line class record. So that's something to keep in mind when you're out there, it seems like a lot of information, and, you know, it sounds like, you know, whenever I give this spiel, so to speak, it sounds long-winded to even me. But the main things to keep in mind are take as many photos as possible, right? Photo of you with the fish, photo of the rod and reel you're using, the scale, all that. Maintain your tackle, you know, keep it, cut it off. You don't want to catch a record fish, right? And then keep using that lure, get it stuck on a log, and then you don't have it anymore. And you have no proof that that's what you were using. So if you do think you caught a record fish, you know, cut your tackle off, put it in a Ziploc bag, put it in your tackle box. And then you know, we're a wealth of knowledge over here as well, too. I love when someone calls me and says, hey, I think I just caught this fish. Can you walk me through what I need to do? Can you walk me through the steps? And to see that come full circle and somebody actually get a record, it's great. It's why I do what I do. So, you know, for you guys to give me the platform even here, just to kind of give that little pitch, 5-minute pitch, if that turns into somebody viewing this, you know, actually getting a record one day, that's awesome. So that's why, you know, I think stuff like this is great. And, the opportunities that me and Andrew have, you know, created by opening up these vacancies, if that's going to lead to, you know, someone who is interested in learning about these smaller, you know, smaller species and these smaller river ecosystems, and if that turns into them caring a little bit more about them and, you know, caring about conserving them as a whole, I think it's great all around.
Well, and folks, don't forget, if you're interested in record fish, you need to be a member of IGFA, igfa.org. Go ahead and join. You'll get a copy of the record book, which has all the rules. And the rules, as Zach was explaining, are extensive. And it's great to have a copy of them because everybody else's rules, to the extent they reasonably can, I think they try to copy the way IGFA does things. And nobody has more demanding records than IGFA. So if you meet the IGFA records, you're going to be in great shape with your state or anywhere else.
Zach, is there any reason for an angler from New Jersey to be a member of the IGFA?
Oh, God. So, I like to just make Ed.
You'd get a kick out of this. Hang on. So, you know, I grew up in Eastern Pennsylvania, but I learned how to fish in Cape May, New Jersey. I'm a saltwater guy at heart. That doesn't mean I didn't catch bass in New Jersey growing up. Went to high school in Northern Jersey. So I caught bass there. And then two of my coworkers here were also from Jersey as well. One's from Barnegat. So we have a pretty strong Jersey and Pennsylvania contingent over here. And there's tons of record opportunities. And I understand this is a Bass After Dark podcast, you know what I mean? But, you know, we've opened up, we have something called our All Tackle Length Record Program, which is something that's open and available for these bass species as well, these black bass species. But if you're heading down the shore at any point in time, you know, weak fish, striped bass, fluke, they're all relatively attainable records. So I would say, you know, if you're listening to this podcast and you're from New Jersey and you're not just a bass fisherman, you know, I would encourage you to join and just see what we have available. And to kind of circle back to what Ken said, I obviously would encourage you to become a member of the IGFA as soon as possible, right? But you do not have to be a member to submit a world record application. You have to be a member by submitting a world record application, right? So if you catch a fish and you're not a member of the IGFA, that doesn't mean you can't submit a record. It just means that through your application form, you need to sign up as a member. And memberships are good for a full year. So it's not something that you're committing to for life, so to speak, although I would encourage it.
Plus, IGFA is in Florida, which even adds to their credibility.
Exactly.
Jeez.
And somehow, some way, we determined we were going to work with people who went to the University of Georgia, too. So we have that feather in our cap as well.
It's unbelievable how much this panel has going for it, except for, of course, Steven Bardin. But
I'm just sitting here thinking about the fact that y'all's Florida smallmouth bass record would not pass Andrew's test.
I'm just saying, when Florida had the smallmouth record, Steven, it was over 14 pounds. Let's not ignore that. That is no.
Andrew, I'll ship that fish to you on Monday.
Yeah. Steven, it seems to me like with all these changes and new recognized species and stuff like that, it seems like we've taken the big three in the Micropterous genus, largemouth, smallmouth, spot, and we sort of turned them into the big four with largemouth, smallmouth, spot, Florida. Oh, you're going to go five? There's a big five now?
Yeah, you better add Alabama bass to that.
Yeah. Okay. And we're still going to keep Punctulatus as one as one of the five as well. So we got two spotters, two former spotters. If I tripped
to Table Rock this weekend, I'd break that spotted bass record.
Well, it's a buck and a half now.
I encourage it,
Steven. Yeah, there you go. That's what everybody needs to do. Everybody who catches a fish between a pound and a half and 2 pounds needs to send an application to Zach.
if that record moved up incrementally 1 ounce every single time somebody submitted an application for him, that would be music to my ears.
You'd get so bored.
you would hunt me down like an animal, and I'm not what would happen to you, so I'd be afraid.
What would happen is Andrew would say, "Stop sending me pictures of spotted bass." I get it.
Guys, I've had so much fun on this show. I've learned a lot. Not everything made me happy, but everything made me a little smarter, and I appreciate that. I can't say that about every show. So I don't know if Terry or BTC had anything else, but you guys have been amazing.
Absolutely. Yeah, I learned a lot.
Yes. Thank you, guys. Thank you for the opportunity as well. This has been a lot of fun.
Oh, this has been a blast for us. You got.
Won't be the last time.
Yeah, we'll be back in touch. And Terry and I are gonna ask to look at some of the stuff in your office because we're fascinated by it. And if you're not watching your mail for new Punctilatus records, Terry and I will have a protest coming your way one of these days.
Sounds good to me. I look forward to it. And you guys are more than welcome to drive on down here. Our doors are open. I'd love to show you around.
Fantastic.
That'd be awesome.
Terry will be stopping at a fabulous Pittsburgh dining establishment called Primanti Brothers, which is in Fort Lauderdale, as we go on our way down there. Zach, you been to Primanti Brothers?
Oh, of course. Yeah.
Great stuff. Gentlemen, thank you so much.
Steve, do you know what Primanti Brothers is? Do you know what good food is?
He's from Texas. He's on a diet of 100%.
He's got big fish saying they ain't got good
Tex-Mex.
All right.
BTC, gentlemen, Steven knows this. He's been on the show, but BTC is very fond of taking the guests off one at a time and snapping his fingers to do so. So
it's my power trip time.
Yeah.
Yes. Andrew, thank you. Thank you for joining us tonight.
Thanks for having me.
Blurred out background, everything that people really love you tonight. Appreciate it.
You represent UGA well.
All right. Zach, I nailed that name, didn't I? Let's talk about
that. Yeah, you did. I was very impressed. And to be honest with you, I don't think the other three members of this would have been able to do that, given where you're from.
Bellapigna.
There you go.
Come on. A little credit here. Come on.
I'm just showing New Jersey some love.
That's what's up. Dude, thank you, man. Appreciate you tonight.
Of course. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Zach. And there's a Texas guy.
Big guys.
Whatever.
You still love me, Steven?
I feel like a proud papa because I've been trying to get Andrew on podcast after podcast after podcast for the last year, maybe even 2 years, as he keeps doing excellent work in Black Bass Genetics. And you guys are the first global people to accept.
Well, we're growing. We're working on it.
Oh, man.
Andrew was a terrific guest, and you are an all-star guest. What does that make? Does that make like between this podcast and also, of course, this podcast also being the Big Bass Podcast? That's five appearances for you.
I think it's 17. Feels like it, at least.
Could be 17. It's hard to keep track anymore. You are not just an honorary member of these shows, but you're a member of these shows, Steven Bardin. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me, BTC.
You ready?
No, remember, object permanency. You're not going to act that hurts. Here. Don't. It's not painful. It'll be okay. What do you think, Dr. Battisti? Good show?
I think that someone called me Dylan Mulvaney in the comments, and I'm
the first comment. You've been sitting on that the whole time, huh?
Yeah. I mean, holy crap.
Maybe it's the Bud Light.
Where's my Bud Light at?
Exactly.
That was a great conversation. I don't agree with it. With respect to the largemouth bass genus, I'm hoping that they can either figure out the right way to do it or add another column to it with respect to a hybrid.
You know, I'm with you on that. I don't know that I have a complete solution, but I know I have some thoughts that I would like better. But I was impressed with the amount of consideration and effort that went into it. I'm impressed with those guys. And that makes me feel better about it, even though I'm not 100% on board with the way it may have been handled.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, they are in a scientific community that everything is their I's have got to be dotted and their T's have got to be crossed, and they have to have you know, peers review all that crap. So there's, they had to do their work. There's no doubt about it. It just so happens that I don't agree with some of it.
Yeah, you know, in answer to tonight's question, BTC, is a new world record bass right around the corner? I think the inevitable answer is yes. Look at all those open categories. We're going to have world records rolling in right away.
There's no record for the Florida largemouth.
Not right now.
It could be set tomorrow.
Yeah.
Literally the first person to enter one's going to have their name in the record book.
Yeah.
And nobody's paying attention.
I'm sure we've got millions of viewers tonight. Millions. This may be the biggest audience the Big Bass podcast ever reached.
it's hard to get people to understand that this is happening, but whatever.
It is. Well, we're not done. I know we're into hour 7 of this particular program, but we're not nearly done, Dr. Battisti. Mm-hmm. There's more to come.
How's the leg holding up there, kid?
It hurts. Good.
Yeah, sorry to hear that, man.
Yeah, you can give me all the crap that I gave you about your shoulder. Karma's a bitch, right?
That's why you're here, buddy. All the
way to You know, BTC did this show, did Bass After Dark, the same day he had his shoulder surgery. Terry Battisti does this show the same day he breaks his ankle. And honestly, I was thinking I was in too bad a shape, just sniffling, sneezing, all that, to do the show tonight and make it through and not be blowing my nose every 4 minutes. But I could not let these guys, you know, out man card me. So here
and as usual, Ken, you did a phenomenal job.
Oh, hold up. There was not even close.
I know sarcasm when I hear it.
Now, hold up a second. Hold up a second.
Hold your horses.
Where's that comment at? Somebody took
a shot at me.
Ken's doubled up on the Sudafed and dominating again tonight. Can't knock the Duke down.
Well, Dave, our viewers and listeners are so astute because they realize that when you're comparing, you know, devastating shoulder surgery, a broken ankle, and a case of the sniffles is the most the most demanding and challenging.
Yep.
and I got game. I got game.
Yes, you do. You do.
Is it quite
gamey?
Well,
speaking of comments,
all right,
let's see. We have bad comments.
For someone to say that the JT only needs to be that's an easy thing.
Oh my gosh, that's
so damn good. Snuffleupagus.
I know. I'm sniffing and sneezing, and Jacob was waiting in the wings, ready to take over for me. He had his knife out. It was ready to plunge right in my back and take over for me. Y'all would have never seen or heard from me again.
I guess I gotta return my smoking jacket now.
What do you think, Jacob?
They probably would have held up in the conversation better than I did. I was lost, man.
I'm muted.
Huh? I'm sorry. Did you say muted or neutered?
I'm muted.
How was the chat tonight, Jacob? Pretty lively. Was it good?
Oh, it's always good.
Excellent. What you got for us, man? You're a guy who studied biology. You got a degree in the natural sciences. How did you enjoy the conversation?
I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it a lot. Hear anything.
Unbelievable. All right. Tell us about the bad comments you saw, Jake. What you got for us?
All right. We got Chris, make a fashion statement by tucking in the smoking jacket into the sweatpants.
Chris, I'm not wearing sweatpants. I got shorts on, actually.
No pants.
Or sometimes no pants. It's always an option.
Ron Jaworski. Terry looks like everything rock and roll rebel.
Okay, Ron Jaworski, not only were you quarterback of the Eagles in the 70s and early 80s, but you're hilarious.
Terry looks like he's either in pain or taking a dump, maybe.
Oh, man.
Terry, you got anything for that? Terry, you got anything for that?
No rebuttal? Just going to sit there and take it.
Nothing? Nothing? You can't just let these people have their way.
Yeah.
0017 Bulldog. I haven't seen this many doctors since my colonoscopy.
And he went Bulldog. I like the Bulldog reference there. Nicely done.
I'd just like to add that we stole Fran Brown from you. Go Syracuse. Thank you.
Syracuse. All that means is he won't play in any games of consequence in January.
Ken is high enough.
Talk to me in January.
Magnets.
Ron Jaworski. Terry looks like a closeted version of Dylan Mulvaney.
Wow. The gloves are off. This whole bad comments thing is turning
Ron
against
Ron is throwing haymakers. I think he's Terry's Pete Jablowski.
He's Terry's arch nemesis is what he is.
The way Jacob came in here, I'm positive he buys chloroform at BJ's.
Not even sure what that means.
Carry on.
Drop
you would put that one in there. That's not even funny, bastard.
This is though.
I didn't send you them stuff.
Yeah, that was a setup. Relax.
Come on. There was funny ones on there tonight.
Relax. We're getting there.
Come on.
Steve Bardin looks like if Matt Robertson shaved off his mullet.
Wow, that's cold.
I actually looked at that and I saw the similarities.
Fat Cat, how much to get Ken Duke to fart in a jar and mail it to a friend?
What the hell, Fat Cat?
What the hell, Fat Cat?
Oh my God. Now there's a funny guy, Fat Cat Newton.
Our friend Paul Benson, how much did Ken pay these guys to say the Florida bass is better than the California bass?
Apparently not enough, Paul, because they didn't stick with my theory, which I think should be known as Duke's Law because it's pretty well established now.
How the hell did Terry not hear anything?
I don't know.
Anthony Geis, Terry looks like Bunsen from the Muppets if Bunsen had hair.
How does he know that?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Nathan, you have that.
Nathan, come on.
Oh my God.
Does he have the? Oh yeah, look at that. Look at that. Oh, just freeze that. My God, that's good.
All right, Nathan. I can hear you now.
And we can hear you.
I don't have that image handy. Sorry.
All right.
I have no idea what happened.
Nathan speaks.
That's the only time Nathan did not have an image ready for us. He's never failed us.
Thanks a lot, Anthony. Guys, I love you, man.
Dude, I got to find that.
You weren't the only target. Don't worry. Ken has a box of Kleenex real close.
I've been reading them. I can read them. I couldn't talk.
Ken has a box of Kleenex real close because all this Latin being spoken is tickling his loins.
There's that. Oh, there it is. That's on BTC's phone. I love it. That is exactly the image.
I got to meet guys someday, dude. He right here.
Whenever Terry talks, he sounds like my grandpa yelling at the TV.
Who is Ron? What have you done to piss off Ron Jaworski, Terry?
Paul English, an allergic reaction, a shoulder surgery, a broken ankle. This podcast should be renamed Cripples After Dark.
You may be onto something, Paul.
He's right.
You're exactly right. But we soldiered through. Bad shoulder, bad sinuses, bad ankle. We pushed through.
Who did Jaworski play for? Was it the Jets or was it the
Eagles? Started with the Eagles. He was mostly the Eagles guy, but he did play for somebody else at the end of his career, but I can't remember who it was. Maybe it was the Jets. I'm not sure.
Dolphins.
Was it the Dolphins?
don't know. Maybe.
I don't know.
Could probably.
Oh, maybe it was the Rams.
Anyway. Don't care.
Might have been the Rams. Wasn't the Dolphins because they would have had Marino and he was. Anyway, Chris.
Who cares?
Said one type of bass decided they would stop putting out, and the male started looking other places and created the mess we have now.
I think that's the essence of our conversation tonight, Chris. I think you've nailed it.
Ken sounds like Biden now calling everyone Jack.
Who's calling everybody Jack? That's a fact, Jack.
You did say it once.
Did I?
So once. I think Ron Jaworski is our MVP for the week.
Yeah.
Jaworski's killing it.
We'll finish it off with waves, currents, and ice. Terry is giving Mrs. Doubtfire after menopause vibes.
Damn right. Damn right.
I got Mrs. Doubtfire a lot last week with that wig on.
is that what we got there, Jacob? Is that what we got?
Oh, wait. I got one last one. Sorry. Ken and Terry going through all those files would be like teenagers finding an entire library of Playboys, making pages stick together.
Really, that would be amazing. Terry made the same.
I had that same vision in my head too.
Yeah.
We're going. We've already talked about going. Now, at the time we talked about going, we didn't know they were in Zach's office.
No.
But that's just going to make it easier for us to track them down.
I mean, that gave me a boner.
Didn't piss them off too bad.
It didn't kind of give me a boner. It did. Did you guys see that I couldn't close my eyes for a while?
We try to keep the level of the show up here.
Oh, I'm bringing it down, baby.
Yeah, Dr. Battisti and I will be in Dania Beach, Florida at IGFA headquarters sometime soon.
Yes. Yep. And hey, just wanted, before we wrap this up, anybody still watching? If you're on YouTube, run over to Facebook real quick, like and share the feed. If you're on Facebook, like and share it. Because in a moment here, we're going to announce our winner for the Missile Bait Greenfish Tackle prize pack from Lures in Lead. And guys, go follow Lures in Lead. Follow them on Instagram, Facebook. Cool site, releasing new things each week, like new little batches, exclusive stuff. Totally rad.
We really appreciate their support, and you're going to appreciate the prizes they offer.
That's right. That's right.
Jacob, thank you, man, for another great episode of edition of Bad Comments.
Yes.
A lot of them directed at Dr. Battisti, which I also appreciate.
Yes.
Hey, they're Jacob's picking on me. It means they're leaving you alone, so I can handle it.
That's what I'm talking about. I have sniffles to deal with. You just have a broken ankle.
Oh, God.
Jacob's going into the randomizer right now.
All right, we ready?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Looks like it's going to be Sean Avery. So,
nice.
What's the deal with that, BTC? Send us the information. Send it to Lures and Lead. You might just want
to
let him know.
Send it to us. Send it to us. Send a message on Facebook. To you, me, or the you don't even have a Facebook, do you?
Me?
Talking to you, boss.
I have a Facebook, yeah.
Okay. Well, send us that your address to one of them sites.
Terry, do you know Sean Avery?
We've been running into each other on the internet for 20 years.
What, when you swipe, long time. When it's you swipe been a long time. Left or what? What?
Hey,
that would be right for him.
Don't.
Oh, I don't know. I don't know how that works.
Don't make fun of my Grindr account.
No,
I would never do that. I would never.
Yuck.
That would be wrong.
You sound like
I can do
sorry,
that.
Aunt. I'll make it up to you.
BTC, you want me to do that right now?
Yeah. Before we let's say goodbye to Jake. Jacob, thank you.
Yeah, and, Jacob, thank you so much, man.
Thank appreciate you.
See you.
Another great Bad Comments. And Jacob would have done a fabulous job filling in for me, but I decided I was feeling just good enough to give this a run. And I didn't want to miss this show.
I had a monologue written, don't worry.
Oh, I want to hear it later.
Maybe.
I want to hear it now.
I want to hear it for after Bass After Dark. No, you don't have that kind of power. ABC has that kind of power. Yeah, let me throw in a quick plug for a wonderful sponsor of ours, the Bass Tank. And if you're not familiar with the Bass Tank, what the Bass Tank does is they help anglers, no matter your skill level or how much you're looking to spend, they get to get more out of your fishing experience. So whether you're looking to upgrade to the latest available sonar units or you just want some basic electronics for your boat, check them out at thebasstank.com.
Yes.
Great people, great products and services.
Yes, indeed. Outstanding. And installation second to none.
Yes. The stuff is so sophisticated these days. And then the different units can work against each other if you're not careful. And that is an amazing niche that the Bass Tank fills, because they're going to make sure you get the most bang for your buck and the best performance possible out of all your equipment. And with that, I think I'm done. I think you guys kicked me to the curb now. And Terry, you get to hang around. Terry needs to hang around for After Bass After Dark.
Indeed. And we got the top 10, man. So don't go nowhere, folks. Ken, thank you. We'll see you in a little bit.
All right, man. Now, it's just you and I.
Now, yes. Yeah. Now it's time for the top 10.
Time for the top 10.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. So, okay. Top 10 signs you're in a bad bass club. That's number 10. Boyd Duckett is president, but you don't remember an election. Number 9. Youth director was a frequent flyer on Jeffrey Epstein's plane. Number 8. First rule of your bass club is that you don't talk about bass club. Number 7. Angler of the year for the last decade has been Mike Long. Number 6. Club tournaments begin with a shotgun start, killing the last place angler from the previous event.
All right.
Number Terry, 5. Yes.
Terry, I'd like you to read the next 5 in a different manner, because this manner sucked.
What?
Just become somebody else for the last 5.
Become somebody else?
Add something. Let's go.
Number 5. Club initiation involves a hookless slugger bunker and a vat of KY jelly. Number 4. Secret club handshake does not involve hands. Number 3. Angler of the Year trophy looks suspiciously like Little League participation award. Number 2. The tournament big fish pot is a deep fryer. And number 1, the sign that you're in a bad bass club, you're the only one at the meeting without a guitar.
All right. I got a feeling Ken will not allow us to have guests read the top 10 for quite a while.
Why? What was wrong with the way I was reading it?
I could be wrong.
Was I too loud? I was trying to emulate Natty Ben Ben.
You're stupid dumbass.
Thank you.
Yeah. Hey, thanks guys for watching tonight. Appreciate everybody that hung out with us. Please tell a friend, like, share, subscribe, push the button, touch the screen, anything to help. We put a lot of time in this thing. Want to thank our guests tonight. Steven Bardin, always a great guest. Andrew Taylor. And Zack Bellapigna, they were awesome. Interesting topic, and we'll see where it goes. Right, Tara?
Yep, absolutely.
That's right. Want to thank Mr. Duke for sucking it up with the sniffles, and Terry, even though he's still here, we'll thank him and apologize for what's coming. I'm kidding, Tara. Thank Nathan for all his work behind the scenes, and Jacob, and to our fantastic logo maker, James Riley. And Ken always gets in my shit for messing this one up. Where's it at? Forgot it. Ron Stallings for the intro. We'll be back next week. Damn. I don't know the show topic for next week. Boy, shit the bed tonight, guys. Apologize for that. And thank you to our sponsors, the Bass Tank and Lures and Lead. And now it's time for Dark Thoughts.
Did you go outside last night? Nah, one night. Nah, it's extremely bizarre. Nah. Definitely shock and disbelief.
And now, Dark Thoughts by Brian the Carpenter.
This guy's naked.
That cracks me up every time.
It's so good.
This guy's naked.
It's fantastic.
Oh,
that
man.
That really happened. For anybody that don't know, that really happened. So what did we learn tonight, Tar?
Oh, that the world record largemouth is messed up now.
That everything we thought we knew about bass was a lie. Right? We grew up calling it Micropter salmoides. It's a lie.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
You know, fossil fuel.
Yeah.
Doesn't what come about from decaying dinosaurs. That was a lie. We were told that in school.
Well, we were told that in school, yeah. But then, you know, it was from algae and crap, you know. I can
fossil fuel. That was a lie.
Well, they're fossils. They're fossils from plant life.
We'll get into this afterwards. No, that was a lie.
God.
No, it's
all right. All right, bass is a lie, fossil fuels a lie. What other lies?
Contrails, Vietnam War, Iraq War, COVID. You know, what else is a lie, Tar?
That you're a man?
I mean, I could show you.
I don't know. What else is a lie, BTC? Oh, great. Yeah, so I guess it's me. Thanks, BTC. I love you. Thank you, folks, for another episode of Bass After Dark. We appreciate you guys coming through here, and we hope to see you next Thursday night, for another discussion that you can only find here on Bass After Dark. Thank you. Oh, you guys are just horrible. All right, well, let's just look at some fish and tackle here. All right. Here we got a triple trout that's probably from, not probably, it is from 2000. And a prototype. Yeah, that's a big one. There's a prototype Nazuma rat. That was, I think it's 2002. Scott Whitmer and I have been best friends since we were like 15 years old. So anyway, so what's up, man? You throwing me under the bus right there, right?
No.
No?
That was good. That was cool. All right.
Yeah.
That's a wrap. We out. See you guys next week.
Adios, guys. Everybody.